Let me paint a picture for you all. It's 1998, and NASA has just learned that an asteroid the size of Texas is heading directly for Earth, threatening to destroy life as we know it on this planet. And it's up to the ingenuity of a ragtag team to try to save our precious Earth.
Damage? Total, sir. It's what we call a global killer. The end of mankind. Doesn't matter where it hits. Nothing would survive, not even bacteria.
My God.
This is the premise of one of the best space movies of all time, Armageddon, starring heartthrobs Ben Affleck and Bruce Willis. There are a lot of movies out there that have this whole asteroid killing Earth narrative.
The final mission to save mankind has failed. The 70-mile-wide asteroid known as Matilda is set to collide with Earth in exactly 3 weeks' time.
This is not real. This is not real. This is not real. This isn't happening.
And we'll be bringing you our countdown to the end of days, along with all your classic rock favorites.
Is this a scenario you spent any time thinking about?
Not too much, because, you know, it's pretty much just science fiction to me.
It's very real. It could be very real.
What if?
No, because hopefully I'll be in the impact zone, so, and wiped out pretty quickly.
It's probably going to hit the Earth, and there's, like, nothing we can do to stop it.
I'm not going to let that keep me up at night.
It's a little freaky.
I'm sure it's always a possibility.
But what if I told you this wasn't all science fiction? That scientists here on Earth are actually preparing for this type of scenario? From the Stowers Institute for Medical Research and KCUR Studios in Kansas City, this is Seeking a Scientist, a podcast where science fiction meets reality. I'm Dr. Kate Biberdorf, aka Kate the Chemist, and in this episode, we're going to meet one of the masterminds behind a real-life Armageddon experiment. How much is this mission like what we see in the movies?
I'm sorry, are we not being clear? We're trying to tell you that the entire planet is about to be destroyed.
Are asteroids really something you and I should be worrying about?
The fact that our planet and other planets are actually hit by asteroids is not science fiction. It's actually science fact.
Let's start by reviewing some fifth grade science. Our solar system has one sun and eight planets: Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. Pluto used to be considered a planet, but in 2006, a group of astronomers decided to redefine planets, thus Pluto was demoted to a dwarf planet. By the way, the planetary scientists were and still are very angry about this decision. For the purpose of our discussion, we're just going to say that Pluto joins four other dwarf planets, 293 moons, 3,800 comets, and 1.3 million asteroids in our solar system. And we are just one teeny tiny part of it. So I want you to think about this. Every day, Earth's atmosphere is hit with more than 100 tons of dust and sand-sized particles coming from space. And every year, thousands of meteorites make it to Earth's surface. Before you freak out, though, allow me to distinguish between the different types of flying death rocks that threaten our very existence. Asteroids are rocks that orbit the sun. Comets also orbit the sun, but they are made of dust and ice. We say meteoroids to describe a rock when it's doing its thing in space, but as soon as it hits our atmosphere, we call them meteors. Any rock that survives the fireball and lands on Earth's surface is called a meteorite. So yes, these things do make it to Earth's surface, but thankfully our planet has a protective atmosphere that's made of a mixture of gases, and they basically work together to act like a giant lab coat for Earth. When a meteor enters our atmosphere, it squishes all these gases together quickly, and that process releases so much heat that the meteor ignites upon entry. Those of you that have seen a shooting star have witnessed this very thing. However, our atmosphere can only do so much to protect us from incoming debris. And when it does get through, it can cause quite a ruckus. In 1908, an asteroid exploded a few miles above Siberia, causing a 3 to 5 megaton explosion. It flattened 80 million trees, killed herds of reindeer, and three people lost their lives. Then in 2013, a meteor exploded over Russia, and once again, a huge shockwave was triggered. Thousands of buildings collapsed, and almost 1,500 people were injured. Scientists estimate that this meteor had 30 times as much energy as an atomic bomb before it entered our atmosphere. And we're not always this lucky. Every 2,000 years or so, really big meteors, ones the size of football fields, hit the Earth and cause significant damage. Every few million years, prepare yourself for this one, an object comes along that is large enough to threaten Earth civilization, like the Chicxulub asteroid, the second biggest asteroid that's ever collided with Earth. You probably know it as the infamous dinosaur-killing asteroid that landed just off the coast of Mexico 66 million years ago. So the fact of the matter is that these asteroids are out there, and it's just a matter of time before they come in contact with our planet again. The question I had was, how detrimental could that be for us? For the plants, animals, and humans that live here? To figure out how serious this all is, NASA has directed resources into what's called planetary defense. They've enlisted an international group of scientists and engineers to work on a very special mission, the DART mission. DART stands for Double Asteroid Redirection Test, and the goal of the mission was to use something called kinetic impact to alter the motion of an asteroid in space. Basically, they were trying to change the movement of an asteroid in an attempt to save the planet. To break all that down for us, I'm bringing in my new friend, Dr. Nancy Chabot. Nancy was the DART coordination lead, and she started working on this project in 2015 in the Applied Physics Lab at Johns Hopkins. She's been on 5 field teams searching for meteorites in Antarctica, and
I have an asteroid named after me, 6899 Nancy Chabot. It's an amazing honor. You get this by your colleagues nominating you, and I was really surprised when I found out that I had one, and I just love it. I will point out that asteroids, my asteroid and other ones that are named for people, are not a threat to the Earth, so no one has to worry about asteroid Nancy Chabot coming and destroying civilization.
That was going to be my follow-up question. Is this something that we could see if we had a telescope here at home?
No, my asteroid is very small. Asteroid 6899 Nancy Chabot is quite small, and most telescopes wouldn't be able to find it. But the largest ones did find it. And so that's sort of, they find a lot of objects. I mean, telescopes are always looking at the sky, always trying to understand what's out there. And they find a lot of new objects, and these new objects need names. And so, you wouldn't be able to just take your average telescope out and see it.
That's true for a lot of asteroids in space, including the focus of today's episode, Didymos. Like at least 150 other asteroids, Didymos has a small counterpart, a moonlit asteroid named Dimorphos. And just a quick side note, whenever I say moon in this pod, know that I'm referring to Dimorphos, not Earth's moon. Dimorphos is actually a really small asteroid that orbits another asteroid, Didymos. Now, we've known about Didymos and Dimorphos since around the early 2000s, but it wasn't until 2017 when NASA's Planetary Defense Coordination Office selected them as the targets of Nancy's DART mission. At first glance, the real-life Armageddon experiment that NASA signed off on might seem a little wacky. The gist of it is this. First, we pick a moon that is orbiting an asteroid that is very far away from our planet. Then, we launch a spacecraft from Earth and intentionally crash the spacecraft into the moon. Then, we study that moon for years to see if we were able to change its orbit. And, you know, see if we can save Earth from future killer asteroids. The price tag for this? $330 million to crash a spacecraft into a moon almost 7 million miles away from Earth. But Nancy's team convinced NASA to do this. I just love to highlight just badass women in science, and you are like the perfect person to have on the pod. And so I want to start at the very, very beginning. I mean, how do you even get into planetary defense? Did you watch Armageddon and decide this was the right path for you?
Well, I think I got into planetary defense from planetary science. I think I just was always very into understanding our solar system, trying to understand how the planets came to be, how the Earth came to be. And then planetary defense, things hitting our Earth is just one aspect of that. And it was a really natural segue. I will mention that Armageddon is actually my sister's favorite movie. I've questioned her on this choice, but she insists. So, I have watched it a few times with her.
People seem to be obsessed with asteroids, and in particular, it's those Hollywood writers. Why do you think that is?
I think obsession with asteroids, especially as might relate to movies and other sorts of science fiction, is because it's a real thing. You know, sometimes things in science fiction have to take a little liberties, but the fact that our planet and other planets are actually hit by asteroids is not science fiction. It's actually science fact. And the fact that this can have devastating consequences is also science fact. This isn't science fiction. We know if large objects hit our Earth, that they can, you know, cause mass extinctions, like for the dinosaurs. And so in that sense, I think it's a really attractive topic to talk about because it is based in enough reality that you can go ahead and create this scenario that is really compelling.
Well, what do the writers get right or wrong?
Well, they get right that the Earth and other planets are naturally hit by objects all of the time. This has gone on for billions of years. It will happen in the future. It's very rare, you know, so we should take steps to do something about it. But the part that they get wrong a lot of time is that, like, these giant objects are all of a sudden discovered with very little warning time and they're going to hit the Earth.
What's going on up there? Why haven't you guys left yet?
Time's a luxury we don't have.
No time, no time. What?
So, unlike the movie Armageddon, where they bring in Bruce Willis, the oil driller...
Are you suggesting that we blow this thing up from the inside?
That's exactly what I'm saying.
How?
We drill.
Nancy and NASA spent years preparing to fight an asteroid like this.
NASA and other space agencies have been tracking asteroids for decades. And the good news is that ones that are 1 kilometer and larger sort of would cause, like, global extinction and these sorts of things. More than 95% of that population has been found, and none are a threat to hit the Earth for the next foreseeable future, which means about the next 100 years or so. And so that's really good news. That said, smaller asteroids can still cause a lot of damage. That might be regional damage, which could still actually wipe out a major city, a small state, or even a small country. You know, but usually the Hollywood blockbusters are more of a last minute, you know, we haven't been prepared. And actually, we're taking all of these steps to be prepared.
Okay, I want to go back to the very beginning of the mission.
The DART concept was always going to use a moon of a larger asteroid in order to demonstrate the deflection. And the reason for that is because you want to be able to measure how much you deflected it. So if you went and deflected an asteroid that went around the sun, you would still deflect it, but then you would have to measure how much you deflected its path around the sun.
It sounds like picking the right asteroid was obviously an important decision for the mission. So how did y'all even find Didymus, the asteroid, and its moon Dimorphos?
So, I mean, people are looking for asteroids all of the time. And so Didymus, you know, was discovered in the 90s. And even then they knew that it had a small moon that orbited it. It didn't have a name yet at that time, but Didymus, the name in Greek means twin. And it's because there were two asteroids there. But they knew from the brightness of the asteroid that it varied regularly with time. And that's because sometimes the moon would pass in front of it and block some of it, or sometimes it would pass behind it and even brightness would go like that. And so they knew this was this smaller object rotating around this larger asteroid. But it was really the DART mission that made these asteroids sort of separate from the rest of the giant crowd that exists out there. So when they became the target of DART, the Double Asteroid Redirection Test Mission, that's when there was a lot more interest and a lot more people then turned their telescopes so we could characterize them as well as we possibly could before DART crashed into Dimorphos.
To summarize, Nancy's team picked the moon Dimorphos because it orbited a known asteroid, Didymus. Both the asteroid and the moon were millions of miles away from Earth. They were far enough away to keep Earth safe if something went wrong, but also close enough to monitor if the experiment was successful. And just to clear up any misconceptions, Earth was never at risk of being hit by Didymus or Dimorphos.
So Didymus and Dimorphos are absolutely no threats to the Earth before DART's impact or after DART's impact. And so that's always very important to stay straight up front. This was also made them appropriate for a test, right? You know, where you wanted to go and test a new technology that you might use to deflect an asteroid if you needed to, but doing that test now before you needed it. And so Didymus and Dimorphos were chosen because they were this double asteroid system. And the whole idea was to demonstrate asteroid deflection by deflecting how the smaller asteroid went around the larger one. And this was a really kind of ingenious and clever way to do asteroid deflection, to do a test of it in a way that was safe on an asteroid that's not a threat to the Earth, and in a way that you could measure it using these telescopes on the Earth that discovered this asteroid in the first place. That same method could then be used to see how good was this method at deflecting the asteroid?
The plan was simple. NASA was going to intentionally crash the DART spacecraft into a moon and then watch what happened. The first thing they wanted to know was if they could change the duration of the orbit. Before the collision, Dimorphos took 11 hours and 55 minutes to make one lap around the asteroid Didymus. What would happen when the moon was struck by a spacecraft moving faster than 14,000 miles per hour? That's what over 1,000 scientists from 28 different countries on all 7 continents were so eager to learn. When I watched Nancy's interviews from launch day, on the surface, she looked happy and excited, and her big smile never left her face. But I also saw a confident scientist with a healthy dose of trepidation. This had never been done before, and there were a lot of moving parts, a lot of money, and scientific aspirations on the line.
There's concern about everything. That's literally part of the job of building a spacecraft, is to be concerned about everything. There's risk lists. What if this happens? What could go wrong? I mean, that's a really important part of doing something that's complicated that's never been done before.
What was actually going to happen when the spacecraft collided with the moon? What if they spent all this money and the methodology doesn't even work? Or worse, what if they miss? What if the spacecraft doesn't even collide with the moon? All of this work would be for nothing. After years of planning, the DART mission all hinged on one launch day in November 2021 at the Vandenberg Space Force Base in California, when the SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket left Earth carrying the DART spacecraft and the hopes and dreams of every scientist that worked on this mission. They were going to have to spend 10 long months monitoring the DART spacecraft's every movement as it moved closer and closer to Dimorphos. If everything went right, the big collision was going to happen in September 2022. So how do you think it went?
I think they missed it.
Probably didn't do nothing to it.
I feel like they probably couldn't knock it off course.
That's crazy.
It's like the asteroid is too strong.
The truth is, no one really knew what was going to go down. We all had our theories about what should happen, but that's what's so fun about being a scientist. We don't actually know until we do the experiment. One thing is for sure, we do not want to be trying this out for the very first time when an asteroid is heading our direction and our lives are actually in danger. We want to be prepared and know exactly how to protect Earth. Can we go back to the day of the launch?
It was a beautiful launch. I was actually lucky enough to be there in person in California and look up.
This is NASA's launch coverage of the double asteroid redirection test.
In a galaxy where asteroids have pummeled planets for billions of years, now one planet strikes back.
And it was just beautiful as it went off into the night sky and it was on its way. You know, while I'm getting to enjoy that and see that in the night sky, people at Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Lab were in the Mission Operations Center just, you know, working for many hours beforehand and then many hours afterwards, because that's kind of a critical time.
About an hour after the launch, the Falcon 9 rocket put DART on the correct trajectory toward the moon Dimorphos and then separated from it. With any brand new space mission that's never happened before, there are risks. There have been so many successes in NASA's mission history. But when things don't go according to plan, it can be really, really bad. I can't help but think of the Challenger explosion that happened just 73 seconds into a flight back in 1986. It's chilling, truly terrifying to think about.
Acknowledging the things that you're concerned about is part of what you do to then be able to do things about them to be ready. And so I think there was always confidence, but there's also unknowns that come up, things that you don't expect. DART actually launched, at, like you said, in November, but we were supposed to launch earlier.
The mission was originally scheduled for spring or summer of 2021, but due to some unexpected setbacks, they were forced to delay their launch.
We always had a backup. We always had margin in the schedule. Things fail. Things are hard. How a team gets through something that goes bad is almost a better sign of, like, than when everything goes as planned.
Nancy was going to be front and center to all of it. If there was a big successful collision, Nancy was going to be able to celebrate on live TV. But if the spacecraft missed the moon entirely, Nancy was going to have to respond to that too. What did that day look like for you? Were you able to sleep the night before? Do you remember that morning?
I slept really well, and I think we were all just ready.
A lot of times in the movies, you see like someone stands up and they give a big speech, and it's right before the mission.
The Bible calls this day Armageddon, the end of all things. And yet, for the first time in the history of the planet, a species has the technology to prevent its own extinction.
Did you give a big speech?
I don't think we needed to give a big speech. I think people were already like properly motivated, had been before that, you know, and at that point, you just stick to the plan, execute the plan.
So in the moment on the day of the collision, what would you have considered or what do you consider a successful mission?
As long as we hit.
Okay.
As long as we collided, that would have been a success.
It was the moment of truth. Was Dart going to crash into Dimorphos, or were we going to watch it sail right by the moon?
And you really didn't know until the last hour, right? It's only in the last hour of the mission that you start to see the small asteroid Dimorphos come out from behind Deimos. And even then, it's still just like a single pixel of light. And the spacecraft's heading towards it autonomously, right? So you're not, no people are there, you're just watching.
I think we're starting to see more resolution. In fact, look at that. Deimos has even gone out of the view. We're now just seeing Dimorphos.
This is remarkable stuff.
If you were watching the live NASA broadcast, you would have heard Dr. Alina Adams, another leading woman in STEM, announce at the 5-minute mark that they had lost the ability to make any more commands because the system had officially taken over. At 14,000 miles per hour, it is just too difficult to have a human in control of the spacecraft. They had to trust the computer.
It's really in the last few minutes that it starts to take shape beyond just a point of light and turning into something that has rocks on it and boulders and has a shape and is an actual little world as compared to just a little point of light. And those are in the final minutes.
Oh my gosh.
Those images were filling everybody's screen and you started to see the surface and you started to see less space and more surface, and you knew that impact was inevitable at that point.
With about 1 minute to go, we started to see these beautiful, crystal clear images of the surface of the moon.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Oh my goodness. Eight, yeah. Seven, oh, six, wow. Five, four, three, two, one.
And then, bam!
All right.
The DART spacecraft slammed into Dimorphos. And y'all, Nancy, and NASA are very happy to report that on September 26, 2022, the real-life Armageddon mission was a success.
And we have impact. We triumph for humanity in the name of planetary defense.
The entire moment was documented by a 31-pound mini spacecraft called the Lychia Cube.
The first Lychia Cube images we saw were pretty spectacular. They showed just so much ejecta going off in this really beautiful pattern, this beautiful irregular pattern of streamers, some bright, some, you know, less bright, some of them wavy, some of them straight, and just so much, you know, difference across the whole thing. And it was so bright and so big.
Scientists later estimated that about 2 million pounds of dusty rock was ejected into space during the collision. That's what they were seeing on camera. After the successful collision, Senator Bill Nelson, the NASA administrator, described it as a watershed moment for planetary defense and a watershed moment for humanity. It was straight out of Hollywood.
Wow, I mean, what an exciting day for the DART team. And in case you're keeping score, humanity 1, asteroids 0. Now, I'm here with Nancy Chabot.
I remember watching a video of you right afterwards. I mean, it was right after because you were live streaming, you were part of the broadcast. And I mean, your smile was so big.
You know, it really is just such the team accomplishment and to get to this moment over so many years. And I don't have to talk about it as coming anymore. It's happened now.
It was amazing to be able to like represent the team doing that, because I think that my smile probably was on lots of other people's faces that you didn't see as well.
Tell me NASA gave you a party. Tell me they did it right.
Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Lab had a nice party, so we were very proud.
I'll take it.
We had a big celebration and it was great to be with colleagues. And then the next morning we just started right away, right? You know, actually the telescope started that night. So why we were celebrating, you know, why we were talking about it, you know, the telescopes in Africa were already sending their data, showing us this brightening and these ejecta that they had seen in Africa, right? And then once Africa's done, then Australia picks up. And so then stuff from Australia starts coming in. And then once they're done, then South America telescopes get to work. And then that data starts coming. It actually became hard to sleep because people were just sharing their new data constantly.
all of the DART scientists immediately started sending in their images of the collision and its aftermath. Since they had teams from all around the world, each telescope had collected data from a slightly different angle.
There was always somebody observing in those first few days and just continuously, and it was so exciting to see it all evolve. And we had a daily helicons and with the team, and just people checking in on the Zoom screen and all their different locations. And it was a really fascinating time, and it was really exciting to just see how much everybody came together in order to really share what they were doing, and so we could maximize the success of DART.
On March 1st, 2023, a full 6 months after the collision, NASA announced that for the first time ever, humanity officially altered the trajectory of a planetary object. Dimorphos's current orbit is 11 hours and 22 minutes. That's about 33 minutes faster than it was before the collision. It turns out that the 2 million pounds of ejecta that was released at the moment of impact actually enhanced DART's push into Dimorphos. In fact, NASA estimates that the change in orbit is 3.6 times greater than if no ejecta had been produced during the collision. See, when DART slammed into the moon, debris was thrown right back into space. You can kind of think of it like when a beach volleyball hits the ground and sends sand everywhere. But in the case of the DART mission, it would be like if the sand then pushed the volleyball off the land. The debris from the collision actually moved the moon closer to the asteroid. If we can affect the orbit of an asteroid's moon, think about what we could do to an asteroid plummeting toward Earth. In theory, if we could get to it early enough, we could collide another DART-like spacecraft into the asteroid and then minimize the damage to Earth. Now, I'm not going to promise you that we're ready to eliminate all collisions with our precious planet tomorrow, but if we keep working on it, maybe our great-great-grandchildren will be able to use this kinetic impactor technology to keep their family safe.
DART was the start in a lot of ways. It's the start of doing planetary missions for planetary defense, taking that first step. But it absolutely is not the last step, right? We've done one technology demonstration. There's a lot more demonstrations to do and steps to take to be in a world where we can protect ourselves from asteroids, which is the goal here at the end of the day.
One thing that's happening is the NEO Surveyor mission. In 2028, NASA is going to send a special space telescope into orbit, whose entire job is to search for big incoming asteroids.
These are the ones that could cause regional devastation, wipe out a city or a small state. We found less than 50% of that population. Now, of the ones we found, none are a threat to hit the Earth for the foreseeable future, but we don't actually know where the rest of them are. And you can't do anything about the asteroids if you don't know where they are. So this is a really important mission for planetary defense, is to get this dedicated space-based telescope that's really good at finding asteroids and find the asteroids and give us that knowledge.
Talking to you has been so incredible. Thank you so much for letting me ask you these questions and picking your brain about DART. But before I let you go, I have a couple rapid fire questions for you. So I'm gonna say two things and then I just want you to pick your favorite, okay? So here we go. Bruce Willis or Ben Affleck?
Bruce Willis.
Yes, that is the right answer. Okay, good. Lord of the Rings or Star Wars?
Star Wars.
Early bird or night owl?
Night owl.
Last one, most important one. Do you have a favorite element?
My favorite element currently is antimony. So
why?
Sorry, it's a weird choice. But I actually say this at conferences. So antimony is my favorite element.
Will you tell me why? No one's ever said that to me.
I know, probably not. So in iron meteorites, it has this really interesting partitioning behavior where it doesn't go into the solid metal, stays behind in the liquid metal, but it's not chalcophile. And so it's this great tracer for the dregs of crystallization of asteroids that gets behind, and the dregs are super enriched in antimony. And it's just so weird, and I love it, and nobody's hardly ever studied it, and I'm planning to do some experiments soon on antimony in my lab.
Oh my gosh, please do. I'm gobsmacked that you just answered that. Oh man, I just absolutely adored meeting Nancy. Her passion for planetary science pours out of her body, and I honestly wish I could have spent more time with her. I did ask Nancy what she projects for planetary defense for the next 5, 10, 20 years, and she had some really exciting things to share. So first, NASA was estimating anywhere between a 7 and 40 minute change in orbit. So this 33 minute change is actually on the high end. We now know that we have the ejecta to thank for that extra push. Second, a group of scientists at the University of Bern ran hundreds of simulations, and they believe that Dimorphos kicked about 1% of its entire mass back into space. That's the ejecta we talked about earlier. They also learned the collision caused the moon to shift 8% of its mass around. So to translate, the researchers don't think Dark caused a crater to form. They think it caused Dimorphos to completely change shape. So naturally...
We have to go back, Kate. We have to go back!
We're going back to Dimorphos. The European Space Agency is going to try to land two CubeSats, or mini satellites like Leetia Cube, on Dimorphos as part of their Hera mission. If everything goes correctly, that will happen around the end of 2026. Now, that's the year I turn 40, so I plan to have a big party to celebrate Hera's return to Dimorphos. And for fun, we might just have to watch Ben Affleck's commentary on the movie Armageddon.
I asked Michael why it was easier to train oil drillers to become astronauts than it was to train astronauts to become oil drillers, and he told me to shut the f*** up. So that was the end of that talk. He was like, you know, Ben, just shut up. I was like, you mean it's a real plan at NASA to train oil drillers? He was like, just shut your mouth.
All right, y'all, that's it for now. But before I let you go, if you've never heard of the DART mission, Google D-A-R-T mission, and you will see a spacecraft fly across the page and slam into some of the text on the screen. Then the entire webpage shifts to the right and looks crooked. It's wild. Thanks for listening to Seeking a Scientist. If you liked it, please write a review or share it with a friend. It'll help us celebrate badass scientists like Nancy and get them that standing ovation they so deserve. Seeking a Scientist is a production of KCUR Studios in Kansas City, made possible with support from the Stowers Institute for Medical Research and design help from PRX. It's hosted by me, Dr. Kate Biberdorf, aka Kate the Chemist. You can follow me on Instagram and TikTok at Kate the Chemist or the pod at Seeking a SciPod. Our senior producer is Suzanne Hogan, our editor is Mackenzie Martin, and our digital editor is Gabe Rosenberg. This episode was mixed by Suzanne Hogan and David McKeel. And special thanks as always to the team at KCUR Studios, Byron Love, Anna Schmidt, and Genevieve de Marteau. And thanks to all the people who spoke to our intern, David McKeel, on the street. If you want to talk to us or maybe share an idea or a question, you can connect with us at seekingascientist.org. You heard clips this episode from Armageddon, NASA, Seeking a Friend for the End of the World, Don't Look Up, Lost, and the Armageddon Commentary. Our original theme music is by Coma Calling, and you heard additional music from Blue Dot Sessions. Stay nerdy, my friends.